water. It's consumed by everyone. In households, schools, hospitals, and any other workplace. It's used domestically, in manufacturing, power generation, and agriculture. Our water comes from rainfall and runoff into rivers, lakes, reservoirs, and other storage facilities. So how does it reach our taps?
Yeah, water is distributed from groundwater or from surface water. Water is abstracted from the sources and then treated in a treatment station. Treatment will remove things like bacteria and viruses, which can be harmful for people's health, but also other substances like just material which is present in the water, sand or suspended material is removed. And after that, after the treatment, when the water is safe to drink, it is put in a network of pipes, bringing the water to your tap at home.
The distribution of rainfall in the UK is uneven across the country. This map shows the United Kingdom divided in two. The Tees-X line has that name because it divides the UK along a line linking the Tees River and X rivers in northeast and southwest England. To the north and west of this line, rainfall is higher than average, often reaching 1,500 to 2,000 millimetres per year. Population density here is lower than average, so demand is small. Areas like this are known as water surplus areas because they have more water than is needed to meet the population's needs. To the south and east of this line, rainfall is lower than average, often as low as 600 millimetres per year. Population density here is high, creating a strong demand for water. These water deficit areas exist because they have less water than they need. In dry years, these areas can be subject to water stress, where the daily requirements of the population wouldn't be met without intervention. So the question is, how to supply areas with a water deficit and prevent water stress?
If you imagine the United Kingdom as a triangle with a pointy top pointing upwards, the upper left is the wettest part of the country, in Cumbria and the western parts of Scotland, where they can receive in excess of 2,000 millimetres of rain per year.
The drier parts of the country are in the lower right part of that triangle. The driest part lies in the lowlands to the east of the Pennines and southwards to the region of East Anglia and southeast England. That puts roughly one third of the rainfall in the northwest.
The areas with water deficit are mainly around London, Kent, that region. Because there is in that region there is less water falling down from rain and a higher water consumption. So the water consumption there is basically more than what is there from precipitation, and that means that there is a deficit in that area. Other areas where there's more rainfall and less use of water can be a surplus of water, and of course, well, the surplus goes down the rivers into the sea in many places.
The UK only occasionally experiences a severe water deficit in comparison to some other countries. However, we do sometimes see extreme examples of water surplus. In December 2015, over 300 millimetres fell on Cumbria, England's highest upland county, in 24 hours, a record rainfall. The city of Carlisle was particularly affected by this event, which caused severe flooding. Several thousand homes and businesses were inundated, with the damage bill totalling £500 million. Broadly speaking, the three main categories of water use are industry and manufacturing, including power generation, domestic and agriculture.
Breakdown of water use in the UK is about 75% used for manufacturing goods and factories. around 20% is used for domestic use, and the rest, 5%, is used in agriculture.
In the UK, 3/4 of water used daily is for industry, especially the big users like energy and chemical companies. Much of what they use is returned to rivers in a perfectly good state, ready for reuse elsewhere. Just over 1/5 is used for domestic consumption, toilets, baths, and showers. This water needs treatment before it can be reused, which is expensive for water companies to achieve. The rest, about 3%, is used for agriculture, irrigating crops during warm summer spells. Regardless of the category of water use in the UK, the demand for water is greatest in regions of highest population density. This map shows the densely populated areas of London, the southeast, and the central and central western regions around Manchester, Liverpool, and Birmingham. If we compare this with the rainfall distribution across the country, we see that most rain falls where population density and water demand are lower.
I think population distribution is the key to understanding areas of stress versus areas of surplus in terms of water availability in the United Kingdom. The region with the highest level of water stress, which we technically define as the amount of available water divided by the number of people who might be dependent upon it, is in the Thames Basin in the City of London. By implication, from a water supply point of view, London is in the wrong place. From a water supply point of view, it would be better if we were able to move it lock, stock and barrel to the northwest, where we've got lots of water.
One of the challenges for water management in the UK is that the areas with the highest water demands are also experiencing the most rapid increases in population. In cities, people use water at home for taking showers or washing the car, whereas factories use it in manufacturing. Offices and hotels add to the demand. The problem is that British cities are now growing fast. In 2016, London had over 8.5 million people, higher than it's ever been before, and will increase to around 9 million people by 2020. That increases demand for water. Managing water supply and demand is nothing new for the UK. Water shortages were common in some regions 40 or 50 years ago, and still occur in certain areas. When all the water infrastructure, pipes and treatment plants were built, the government owned the water industry and supplied it at cost price. In the 1980s, private companies bought the infrastructure and took it over, a process called privatisation. Water company owners have shareholders who invest for profit. It's a good investment because people will always need water, so shareholders get a guaranteed income. The trouble is that private companies always regard big expenditure, like new pipes or treatment works, as a big expense. And of course, that reduces profits. So any plan to create a supply network is expensive and unlikely to be approved by shareholders. The government tries to regulate the industry through an organisation called Ofwat, but they are limited in their powers. Pipe leakage is another problem.
Yeah, pipe leakage in the UK is quite a big problem. If you look at the distribution network, the pipe network in the ground, its parts are very old. Even Victorian age pipes are there. And that means that there is a lot of leakage in these pipes. And of course, you don't want to have that.
We know that the average leakage in the English and Welsh water network is approximately 20%. Some companies a bit better than that, some companies perhaps a bit worse than that.
And that means that you have to treat 20% more water to get the right amount of water at your home. And of course, extra treatment gives extra costs, but also gives more environmental problems with the treatment and of course leaking the water into the ground again.
Over recent decades, there have been initiatives to reduce water consumption. Today, domestic consumption is around 150 litres per person per day. The government's target is to reduce that to 130 litres per day.
So how we get from 150 litres to 130 litres involves thinking about how people in their homes use water and how we can encourage conservation and water efficiency through changing fixtures and fittings, rolling out dual flush toilets that use less water per flush, lower flow shower heads and faucet fixtures, and also encouraging people who use water outside the house in gardening and car washing to do so in a water efficient way.
Hose pipe bans have been used during periods of exceptionally low rainfall.
It is difficult to tell how effective water restrictions for water consumption in the UK are because you cannot enforce these restrictions. But it is of course always important to use your water wisely.
Reduction of domestic water consumption has also been achieved through metering, including offering free meters to London residents. But only about half the UK population uses them, and only about 23% of Londoners. Attempts have been made to address water inequalities. One example is the construction of Kielder Water, the UK's largest artificial lake in Northumberland, completed in 1981. Water from here is discharged into the North Tyne River to compensate for water removal further downstream. The Kielder Transfer Scheme also allows for water to be transferred southeastwards to the Weir and Tees rivers where there are shortfalls. Regionally, this is significant, but nationally, it makes minimal impact because there's no national water grid in the UK, something that has been supported by government but resisted by water companies. When London hosted the 2012 Olympic Games, the construction of Olympic Park saw a major focus on sustainability, including maximising the efficiency of water use. The Olympic Delivery Authority, or ODA, set a target to achieve a reduction of 40% in water consumption. A combination of water-efficient fixtures and using treated wastewater for flushing toilets and irrigating the surrounding parkland reduced water consumption by 57%. There are other examples of sustainable water projects.
Many of them involve what we call sustainable urban drainage systems. These are systems where instead of making sure that rainwater moves away from our towns and cities as quickly as possible, what we do instead is we create structures that attenuate or contain rainwater and slow it down. We do this for two reasons. The first reason is that slow water is less damaging. The second reason is, if the water can be allowed to percolate down into the subsoil and substrates underneath our city streets and our parks, it potentially becomes a resource that we can draw on elsewhere in the water cycle.
What might drive a more sustainable supply and use of water in the future is for the government regulator to insist that the water companies invest much more in infrastructure than they have in the past. Some water companies have invested heavily, like South West Water, the company responsible for supplying water to Britain's most popular tourist holiday region in Devon and Cornwall. It was forced to invest in cleaning up beaches that had suffered from sewage outflow. New treatment plants mean that sewage on beaches in the region is now a rarity, but they only did it because the regulator forced them to. Perhaps the same approach should be taken over establishing a national water grid. What do you think?
I don't think the average person in the UK does know what the impact of their water use is. On the other hand, you can do a lot if you reduce your shower time from 10 minutes to 5 minutes. If people would be aware of that, it would increase sustainability a lot. It could reduce the water use a lot, and it will improve the whole system.
If you like this video, you can find it and so many more at clickview.net. Sign up for free today.